There are no answers, actually. There are no answers. And this is the key to salvation, is realizing I don't have any answer. Why? Because there's no question. Reality is unquestionable. It cannot be questioned. What is there to question reality? There's nothing to question reality. Reality is perfect, it's flawless, it's unquestionable. So there isn't any answer. How could there be an answer if there's no question? There's no question being asked. So really, what our safety lies in recognizing that I don't know. I don't know any answer. I don't know any answer whatsoever. I don't know anything, meaning I don't know any answer. Ultimately, when we can say this with very strong conviction, then this will dispel the remaining clouds. Now, it's Friday. It means a brutal work of week is week of work is over, and time to get down to some serious taping here. I'm still in the grave, along with everyone else. I know that's reassuring to some. They say, no, don't get out of the grave. You know, it's like the crabs in the tank there, the seafood city place, seafood store. The crabs are trying to climb out, and the other crabs grab them and pull them back in. They say, no, you can't leave us. We like your company here. So everybody says, oh, we like your company here in the grave. Yeah, in the tomb here. I say, well, yeah, but I didn't really come here to hang out in the grave. I came here to show you how to get free from the grave. And that hasn't been an easy job, for sure. And what we're trying to make it easier, if that's possible. So, just because we get close doesn't mean we drop our discipline. We keep the discipline, the three-part discipline, full assertions, full stop in the wow, and flipping the script. Sitting quietly is the key to all spiritual practice, the ability to be disciplined, to be quiet, to be non-reactive, to don't struggle with the struggle. You're going to react with elation and trepidation. Just don't try to translate that, sublimate it in any way into something else. Just let it remain elation and trepidation as you see your success, as you recognize, oh, my gosh, yeah, I'm feeling it now. We're told that as we listen to truth, listen to it, gradually it seeps into us and we begin to actually start to feel, you know, hey, this is true. I feel that this is true. And that is, you know, tremendous progress. But it takes place gradually. So don't struggle with your wow feeling. Just say, great, this is progress. Let me just stay quiet, mind in neutral. And just experience this. This is what it's all about. And do we make progress? Absolutely we do. I've been making so much progress, I actually have to be careful. I had to check myself a little bit. Progress might have almost, you know, too much to cope with. And that can happen. You can shock yourself. And you say, oh boy, I don't know if I'm ready for that. And basically, I was able to see just the defenses that we've used throughout history. Our minds, how our minds have been working to camouflage our arrogance. You know, what is arrogance? What we're really suffering from is spiritual arrogance. Some call it spiritual pride. I'll call it spiritual arrogance, because arrogance means to arrogate to something, which means to ascribe a quality to something that it doesn't have. Let's use that definition of it. So you say, okay, you are now, this is your, let's say you arrogate someone a name, say, this is your name. Or say, this is the quality, this is what you're like. Or, you know, this is how you dress, this is how you must, this is, we arrogate, this is your attitude. We tell them, you know, we arrogate to them, we say, this is what you are, this is what you are. So what we did was we arrogated to God what we thought God was. And we said, God, you're imperfect. You're imperfect. Why did we do this? Because then that opened up for us what we thought was the option opened up to us. Like, hey, If we can become perfect, that means we can become greater than God, because God's not perfect. So this is how we played with this idea of being greater than God. We arrogated to God that God, hey God, you're not perfect. Now, this is sheer arrogance, sheer arrogating. It has no truth into it whatsoever. We were not created with any power to change God or change ourselves either. So it's just sheer unadulterated arrogance. And this is our problem. This is our problem. And when we talk about repentance, we go to these videos with a mood of repentance, saying, I need to recognize my arrogance. This is repentance. Repentance means to cut through the camouflage that is camouflaging our arrogance and to see it as it is, as it actually is. Meaning it has no basis, no causation whatsoever. It's not causative. It has no effects, therefore it's not causative. In other words, the arrogating to God that God has changed has no effect. Therefore, this arrogance is not causative. Okay, so it's really nothing. It's just wishful thinking. And so this is repentance. Now we try to camouflage what we've done, and we spend an inordinate amount of time working on this camouflage. And this whole world is actually a camouflage. Bodies, personalities, self-identities, all this self-concept, memory, reaction, all of this stuff is actually a very purposeful work we're doing to camouflage our arrogance, to hide it. We don't want to God to see it. Because if we think if God sees it and says, oh, that's just arrogance, then it won't be causative. But isn't this magical thinking? You know, we've said that to arrogate something to God is causeless because it has no effects. Well, then how does camouflaging the arrogance that change that? Well, we believe it changes it, and this is called magical belief or magical thinking. That somehow, because we've camouflaged it, that it's now causative. And this, again, is just more arrogance. This, too, is baseless. Traceless, baseless, causeless, effectless. That's like saying that you change the packaging of a box. You're changing what's inside the box. We're not changing what's inside the box. So we come here to these videos in a mood of repentance, meaning we're willing to recognize our sheer arrogance is causeless. Okay. It's never had any effect at all. Everything that we've been doing, thinking that it's dealing with the effects of it, isn't. We're really just working on camouflaging it. Now, we can certainly pat ourselves on the back and say we've been very diligent at this and done the best we can at this. And even though all of the camouflage is nothing but a house of cards, I mean, we've dressed the cards up and we've, you know, built this nice house of cards, and we've been very creative at it, so we don't need to hate ourselves for this. We just need to notice it, recognize it, and try not to full stop in the wow of seeing this. I had a dream last night where I saw this. I was like, I guess someone made a deal where I was going to trade my vehicle, this beautiful car, in for some roadblocks. Some like you know, those folding sawhorse like roadblocks that they use, and so someone had built all these roadblocks for me, and I was supposed to trade my car for these. But I looked at them and I realized they were all completely flimsy, just made of like these plastic cards. There was no strength in them whatsoever. And I said, wow. I said, oh, this. But they're very, you know, very tacky and kitschy, and yet there's a lot of effort put into there to try to make them look strong, even though they were completely flimsy. So I've been struggling with that today, saying, how do you respond to that? Well, the first response is just wow, and just stay with the wow. Don't try to come up with some more specific response to it. But it's like, oh, wait a minute. I'm not going to make a deal. I'm not going to go through with a deal with trading my car in for this. And yet we've gone to so much work. We've gone to so much work fashioning this world, haven't we? And yet as a camouflage for our arrogance, it's incredibly flimsy. All our camouflages, and actually in the dream it was made of partly camouflage material, designed camouflage, all of our camouflages are utterly flimsy. Totally causeless. No effects. Doesn't change the fact that we can't change God. We can't change what we are. What we are is perfect. So we get rolling here. We get rolling into repentance. Roll into repentance. Roll into seeing that all we're doing is just trying to camouflage the fact that no deal has taken place. Now, what we did was we arrogated to God the imperfection, and then we felt that this might be a problem for us, and we needed to somehow camouflage the arrogance. So we looked at it as if we were making a deal with God, and we decided, you know, God, we're going to go easy on you. Feel sorry for you. That, you know, we see that you're imperfect. You think you're perfect. We don't want to get you, you know, cranky about that, and it would upset us. So I'll tell you what. We'll tell you what, God. We will drop saying that you're imperfect if you drop saying that you're perfect. And that way we're both happy. You see? We gave a little. I mean, we suffered a little. Both of us suffered, but we both are can be satisfied that, you know, we both, the other one gave in a bit, you see. This is the idea that somehow your happiness comes from the other one, other side of a conflict, giving up something of value. Well, it's pretty funny because since we claim that God is imperfect, which is false, and is completely causeless and has no effect, we have to give it up. But we say, well, we feel so bad about giving that up, God. We want you to give up something also to make it even, you know. And this, in our minds, this is how we think. This is how we've been thinking. And again, we can just look at this and just say, wow, great. Now we're able to see this now without trying to, you know, change it. Don't try to change it right now. Just look at it and just see it. Get used to looking at it and see it. At some point, you'll ease past it. Now, I haven't quite gotten to that point yet. But the discipline is to just look at it. Okay? We're not attacking anything. We're just looking. Just and laughing and lack of that. Okay, I see that. Interesting. Just look at it. So we chose a whim, a causeless, effectless whim of claiming, wanting to be greater than God, claiming, hey God, you're not perfect, and then claiming that the difference is that God's saying, well, I'm perfect. That's not a whim. That's not a whim. So if we think that both us and God are being whimsical, and the way to both of us to save face is to both of us to give in what we feel is valuable. And we think, okay, that's even now. Everything should be fine. The only problem with that is that God is not being whimsical at all. There's zero whimsy to God. It's absolute, pure truth. It's completely causative. Purely causative. So we've been engaged in some... that's camouflaging our arrogance. So we're just looking at this... camouflaging our arrogance, which is what we've been engaged in for so long, using so much creative effort in this. We make religions to camouflage our arrogance, actually. The entire gamut of Abrahamic religions are camouflaging this, our arrogance. We basically arrogate to God all these anthropomorphic qualities, all these conflictual, fearful qualities, you know, and claim that we're in this now delicate dance of relationship with this. Yeah. Sheer arrogance. God, the thoughts of God, the creation of God, the mind of God, the has no preference whatsoever, cannot enter into any covenant with any special group. It's absolutely impossible. God does not have any favorites, any thoughts of specialness, even doesn't have preferences for how our freedom plays out. And again, God never, ever, could, in any way, could ever enter into a deal with at all. Because again, being perfect, what could the deal mean except that it has to be a change to that, right? You have to give it up to get something. What does reality need to get? Why does it need to make a deal? It doesn't need to make a deal. There's nothing it needs to get. And there's nothing it can give up. So it's impossible for reality to enter into any deal. God cannot enter into any agreement at all. Okay? So the idea of entering into a covenant or an agreement is again, sheer arrogance on our part. And then wrapping that up in a religions is again, more arrogance. Non-repentance. And what did Jesus say? You need to repent. You have to repent. You have to stop trying to camouflage your arrogance. Now, was Jesus an Abrahamic religion? A religion's coming from the so-called patriarch Abraham? No, he came to bring a New Testament, actually. And to set us free from that arrogance. Okay, to set us free from this belief system. And they kept putting him into the old wineskin. He said, no, you can't, don't put new wine into old wineskins. But the old habits die hard of this camouflaging our arrogance. We're quite frightened. We've sent up so many roadblocks that we keep running into them. And so we pretty much twisted Jesus into making it seem like Jesus is worshiping the same God as the Abrahamic religions are. And it's not true. It's not true. Jesus is not worshiping this God that we have arrogated qualities to, which God doesn't have at all. Specialness. Choosing special people, special ones. Covenants. Making agreements. Saying, if you do what I tell you to do, then I'm going to give you this land. Even, you know, there's people living in the land. Well, you know, you're special, you're more important to me, so you get to conquer that land and claim that God gave you this land, and you're, therefore you're conquering and slaughtering everybody is justified. You know, covenants. God never enters into any such covenants like that. No special places, people, no specialness whatsoever with God. None. Zero. And this is what Jesus came to tell us. He said, God is a God of pure love. And ultimately, what is love? Freedom. Okay, so ultimately, the nature of God is absolute freedom. And of course, that cannot play any favorites at all. So Jesus came to liberate us from our old traditions, the bad habits, the bad belief habits, our arrogance, liberate us from our arrogance, actually. And what happened was they kind of did their best to stuff him into the cage of tradition and arrogance, and he didn't fit so well in the cage. So they did all sorts of complex runarounds. Evasions, confusions, you name it, to try and say, well, you know, they're both right, you know, both right. The God that we're worshiping, that we've arrogated all these qualities to, that's God, and Jesus' God is also God, same God, but it's not, you know. But they just couldn't. We haven't been able to really just let go, you know, let go with a laugh. Say, okay, that's just this is our camouflage work. That's all. That's all we've been doing. Very good at it. You know, we worked at it very assiduously, and very cleverly, very creatively, telling tales, all sorts of tales of this and this and that, and So we've just been, just let it go at that. It's just camouflage. I say, oh, okay, good work. You know, we did great work, very funny work, and it's kind of like a kid's involved in the crafts, you know, where they come up with something, and it's, you know, it's silly, it's clumsy, it's obviously, you know, a contrivance of they use plastic cups and spoons and old cartons of, you know, basically they go through the garbage in the kitchen and build little cities and little things with the garbage, and it's cute, it's creative, and you say, oh, that's, you know, that's, that was fun, I guess, or, you know, that was something. You don't yell at the kid and say you're stupid, or we have this family, you know, this family, their kids are very creative that way. They make all sorts of very creative stuff out of cardboard and just stuff that people throw away. Okay, just throw away stuff. And okay, that's fine. But then after they're finished with it, what do? It goes outside and throw it away. It gets thrown away. the parents understand that this is something the kids are just exploring, you know, and using this stuff just to see what they can make of it. And that's okay. So that's the same thing with us and what we've been through in this world and maybe other worlds. Through this, you know, through this sojourn in the grave, basically, living death. And so we could recognize it. We say, oh, okay, yeah, this is silly. It's really silly. We've been so earnest at it, you know, working so hard at it, so into it, like kids, you know, building something out of the garbage, kitchen garbage can. We could do that, right? I mean, you can get aluminum cans, and you can, I mean, they work at it. They put some paint, glitter, cake glitter, and things. It's just amazing what kids can, they'll use anything. So we've used, you know, our creativity to concoct this ridiculous camouflage for our arrogance, believing that in not recognizing that it's arrogance, we think it's causative then. It's causative. Well, if it's not arrogant, it must be causative. So just because we camouflage it so we don't see it, do you really think that God says, oh, gee, I guess it must be causative then, because they don't seem to see, they don't believe it's arrogant, so it must not be. But how can God do that? God's perfect. God can't say that God is imperfect. It's not possible. So there's no possibility that anything we've done has any effect on God whatsoever. Now, I've always known this, but coming into this world, you know, it's the people are uptight, you know, about this. They're so uptight. You know, they take it too seriously. They take it too seriously. Don't take this world seriously at all. There's nothing serious going on, actually. You know, a mirage is not serious. Don't take a mirage serious. This dream of causation isn't causative at all. So you need to feel relaxed, at ease, good sense of humor, smile, laugh, and not be vicious here. And of course, those who are, you know, frightened think you're being vicious. Anything that points out its camouflage, they take as a severe attack upon them. Because they think that they're going to lose their causation and then they'll have nothing. How can losing nothing, how can recognizing that nothing is nothing, how can that then result in nothing? It would result in everything, though, wouldn't it? I mean, we'd stop pretending that nothing is something, and then we'd recognize what is. But this is something that the world finds, you know, exceedingly perplexing. You know, like they say, the deluded believe that the absence of delusion is an abyss. Okay, this is pretty much what the situation is here. So it's exceedingly troublesome for the spiritual path to simply to recognize that it's not an abyss. We can recognize it conceptually, but we haven't really relaxed and released ourselves into the truth of it. We may have glimpsed it. We have little glimpses of it now and then. And therefore we recognize, oh yeah, it is so, it is so. I see it. Turn the light on, I see it, and then I shut the light off again. So where'd it go? Well, it's still there. So, the world takes this camouflage very seriously. It feels that camouflage equals causation, which equals, you know, existence, life, being. So we believe this camouflage has magically transformed our sheer arrogance into, you know, made it causative. So it's no longer arrogance. It's now true. And therefore, the camouflage is what is enabling our reality, our experiencing. And without it, we think our experiencing would stop. So obviously, if we look at it this way, you can see why we're so afraid. And why the spiritual path, it seems to be so, so difficult. Yeah, this is a mere trifle, isn't it? It's just ridiculous. And yet, this is what holds everyone in bondage. Because we're so afraid to even take the slightest look at it, even that something this simple, a mere trifle, takes on enormous weightiness and troublesomeness if you're completely unwilling to even look, even take the slightest glimpse of it. Well, then your imagination runs riot. So, of course, once you see it, it's a piece of cake, but let us be just completely transparent about it. If we're super used to not looking at it at all and believing that even the slightest glimpse will cause us to be annihilated, then it's not so simple. It's both simple and it's not simple. Okay? It still remains a trifle, a mere trifle. And yet it's not simple to see that it's a mere trifle for us. And so, spiritual effort often feels very frightening. Absolutely. I've always felt it's enormously stressful and frightening. Still is. Because we're looking at what we have felt for a long time, and there have been religions and thousands and thousands and thousands of years piled up on one another, based on the taboo of looking at this, literally based on it, and taking great pride in not looking, and working on camouflaging our arrogance and not looking at it. You see, that's the pride that we've had. So we have to overcome all of that. So it's frustrating because we say, wait, I just looked at it and now I can't remember what I saw. Our attention fades away. Our attention fades away from it because the taboos are so strong. We think there must be some reason for those taboos. Must be some reason for all those religions. No. Well, the reason is magical arrogance and magical belief of believing that if we camouflage it, that it then becomes causative. And that if we stop camouflaging it, the causativeness will vanish and we'll then be without any experiencing. So this is this little scare tactic we've used on ourselves. That's all it is, really. That's all that it is. And yet just saying that, I can feel, you know, the inner fear just vibrating, just like, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, this is. And my mind, so my mind's trying to fade away from it, you see. So we fade away from it. We fade away from it. And that gets us frustrated because we say, wait a minute, that's simple. Why are we fading away from it? Very frustrating. And then we say, you know, whoever's telling this stuff, they're crazy. Forget about it. I get irritated. The trouble is, the ego's very clever. It keeps asking for explanation, instead of experiencing. And ultimately, we get irritated by explanations given over and over again. We get irritated by it. And so then we get irritated and angry at the truth, thinking, you know, I'm tired of hearing these explanations. Well, ultimately, we have to go to experiencing the truth. It's not just explanations. But we have to maintain some sort of goodwill towards explanations because, again, the taboo has been so extreme that we're only willing to work with just minimal glimpses and then lots of explanation for why did we, you know, why is this, why are we struggling with these glimpses? Why are we struggling? You know, why is it so difficult? We need explanations. We insist upon them. And I get irritated with Jesus, you know. I say, but if you write a book like Journey Beyond Words, you have to emphasize something. If you don't emphasize anything, the book will go on forever. I mean, what's the point? So, of course, Jesus emphasizes something. There's a limited number of pages, and therefore, there's going to be something. We can just the lack of continuing on indefinitely, infinitely with explanation means whatever he did say seems like he's emphasizing it. So sometimes those emphasis you feel it sometimes more, sometimes less, and sometimes it just doesn't feel so. I'm just not feeling it, and I then have to realize, hey, it's okay. I'm just not feeling it right now, and not get irritated with Jesus. Said, I've read that so many times, and you know, I still don't understand it. What's the matter with you? How come you can't help me out more? You know, you get irritated. Why can't you help me out more? I have to just say no. It's okay. He's coming. He's coming from truth, from compassion, from love, from freedom. So his heart, you know, his purpose and intent's in the right place. And there's a limitation with what we demand with being concepts and words, you know, writing words, an emphasis and all that. That puts him in a straitjacket pretty much. So I just pretty much say, well, you know, I know. I'll get this eventually. So, and then again, just because his points of emphasis in a particular book, I may not feel them in a particular day. That's okay. I mean, that's not all the emphasis that there can be. I mean, actually, if a teacher like Jesus can use emphasize anything at all in terms of helping bring us to truth. But if you did that, there couldn't be a book about it. So, just because he puts something in a book doesn't mean that is exclusively saying, okay, this is what I emphasize and nothing else. No, that's not true. There's different ways of looking at it, different ways of speaking about it, different, you know, absolutely there is. There's different approaches to the mountaintop. And you know, I have my own path. I have a path that is the Holy Spirit shown to me, and it's working for me. And I realize it's different than paths that most people are familiar with, which is fine. Everyone has some uniqueness to their path, and you just have to accept that and don't worry about it. As long as the direction, you know, the direction is right, then don't be too concerned. You know, I talk about this deal. You can't make it. God can't make a deal. It's very important for me, that emphasis. Jesus says vision of oneness, vision of Christ, vision of this. I say vision of no dealness, the vision of no dealness. When we're able to see that this no dealness, you know, there's no dealness. I'm seeing there isn't, no deal is ever made. You know, that's enlightenment. That's non-dual abidance, actually. Vision of no dealness. Now, I've never heard anyone ever say this before. But for me, that's just as valid as saying vision of oneness. Yes, it's the same. Vision of no dealness. And for me, that resonates stronger than vision of Christ or vision of oneness or those type of terms. I tend to have sort of, you know, let go of the Abrahamic religions, and I'm not so strongly identified with them. because we have suffered under these efforts at camouflage historically to you know, strong extent. And there's been a lot of conflict generated by this camouflage, a lot of conflict, a lot of guilt trips. And so, you know, at some point you have to say, hey, I'm not thrilled about using the terminology, you know, the terminology that we're in such a tradition of the world. I mean, I'd say a majority of the world is in that tradition, basic tradition, and used to various concepts and ways of thinking, and you know, and praying to God to get a result, and just everything about it, it's all camouflaging our arrogance. That's all it is, actually. All sacrificial belief is camouflaging our arrogance. Absolutely, it is. And I've seen through this through and through and through, as clear as a bell. So, you know, instead of saying vision of Christ, you know, I can clarify that. But for me, vision of no dealness. You know, I feel comfortable with that. That's very non-religious sounding. You know, vision of no dealness. Vision of no dealness. Can't make a deal with God. And it also helps point out this whole idea of specialness and covenants with special people, saying, God gave you this earth, God gave you this land, you're supposed to rule over it, you're the special people, you're the chosen ones. All this chosenness, you're special, and all this again camouflaging our arrogance. He's saying no dealness, that basically, you know, says no to all that's not none of that is work is being emphasized or workable, you know, dropping the camouflage of that vision of no dealness. There's no deal. God doesn't make any deals. Doesn't need to. Everyone has everything. The only deal God can make is something less than that. And God's not going to do that. So God literally gives every all of creation has everything. God shares all creation with all. All in all. One in all in all is God, creation. And so to make a deal would be to come off of this position. And the only way to come off of it is specialness. It's not all has all, which means some have more than others, which means they're special compared to the others. So God cannot do that. There is no specialness. So the whole thing about, you know, our cultural religious history of this planet for many is we've been weighted down with this to an extraordinary extent. It's a mosquito there. Go away, mosquito. I don't want you hanging around here because you're going to get me. Well, it's more interested in the screen right now, which is good. How sneaky. Mosquitoes are sneaky, aren't they? Holy cow, maybe I better put a shawl on so it doesn't put this. Okay, just bear with me. I'm gonna try to protect myself from the mosquito. So we've been barking up the wrong tree for a long, long, long time. And Jesus came to try to free us from that. And yet we just continued barking. We kind of said, Jesus came and said, no, that's not it. And we said, oh, thanks, Jesus. You're so wonderful. Thanks for telling us this is it. And now we have even more confidence in it. It just, our arrogance is so strong that we literally could just twist it that way. I mean, we just decided we'll just twist it. that this is the trouble, is our arrogance, is just believes we can do anything. And indeed, God created us to experience whatever we want to experience, except we can't change what we are. We can't change God. That's the one exception. And we naturally, we decided, hey, let's just decide that that's not an exception. We can change who we are. Well, guess what? We can't. So it's causeless. And we've, again, camouflage the causelessness of it, our arrogance, camouflage the causelessness of it, and then believe that magically we have made it causative. And if we see that it's not causative, so we'll lose all experiencing, we'll be annihilated. This is the conclusion we draw. Okay, this is the result of magical thinking. We scare ourselves. Now, Jesus has shown in his more recent attempts to help us that he's absolutely clear as a bell about all this. And he did promise to come back a later time, and he said, when I come back then, you'll be way better disposed to understand what I have to say. He showed up a couple thousand years ago knowing we had to get started, that we had really gone deep into severe camouflaging of arrogance in specialness and belief in covenants and chose God's chosen people and all this kind of stuff. And he knew it was going to take us a long amount of effort to get dispelled from this, you know, to wake up from this. It's difficult. So he said, well, you got to get started. So he knew it was just a start. That's all. You know, you have to make a start. Once begun is half done, actually. So He knew that we wouldn't get it back then. Jesus was very aware that we were going to distort and twist what he had to say, and we wouldn't understand it back then. He even said so as much that you really don't understand what I'm telling you. But later you will, after the Holy Spirit clarifies everything for you. So he's come back now, and he knows we're way, way, way clearer about what he has to say, and we're much more capable of understanding what he has to say now than we were couple thousand years ago. And this is true, at least in some cases. I seem to be able to, after a tremendous amount of work, to be simpatico with it to a certain extent, and be able to look at it, be disciplined, and so I would say that's, you know, this it's certainly way different than several thousand years ago. That is for sure. Way better. So, you know, basically getting the gist of it, getting the essence of it, getting the root of it, the basics, getting it clear, and that this will eventually, you know, flower into the completeness of clarity. And that's what we're doing. We're just looking at what's really taken place, and, you know, our folly, and forgiving ourselves for that. Is we thought we saw a way, you know, to make arrogance causative and magical belief, camouflaging it. And so once you get into camouflage, it's kind of a slippery slope, to say the least. Because it starts reinforced. You don't realize that you're going down the slippery slope of believing if you stop camouflaging arrogance, the causelessness of it, that you'll lose causation. So this is a very nasty trap, isn't it? That we didn't really recognize because we were so intrigued by our cleverness, supposed creativity and cleverness in camouflaging this, that we didn't really pay attention and see that we were bringing about this extreme trepidation in us about, hey, wait a minute, we thought this camouflage is causative. Okay, again, this is You know, we're really looking at the root of our misery right now, suffering. The grave. Death, actually. It's all wrapped up into this. I've explained that in previous videos. Death easily will give way as, once we get this clear in our minds. We think, we came to believe, because it's our creativity was involved in this, we came to believe that we could create this new causation called camouflage. Camouflaging arrogance. Causelessness. Non-causative. Camouflaging the non-causativeness of arrogance. Telling God that God, this is the way that God is. Changed. Not perfect. So again, believing that camouflage was this new causativeness, new style of causation, we believe if we give that up, we'll stop experiencing. We'll have no causation. And it's only when we start trying to give it up, we say, wait a minute, I'm tired of this camouflage work, you know, it's not really my thing, you know, we feel that, this isn't really my thing. This world is not anyone's thing, it's not what anyone really wants. This camouflage work is not what anyone really wants. It's kind of a silliness, and you know how children, when they're doing, be silly, after a little while they say, ah, I'm not interested in that anymore, and the parents, you know, they don't want to go back to it anymore. Say, nah, I was silly. I got something more interesting now. So all this is just silliness. And yeah, so when we try to drop this silliness, suddenly we get this fear. I say, where the heck does that fear come from? Wow. What is this? This is the fear that we're dropping causation. The camouflage is causation. It's because that we want it to be. We want it to cause arrogance to be causative. So that we can claim that, so that God is imperfect, and that opens the door for us to work to become greater than God by becoming perfect. So this is now about as easy as like giving directions down to a local grocery store for me. You know, it's just like, yeah, okay, go straight down this road for about a mile at the stoplight, turn right, and then take another right. And there's the parking lot, and you go in, and you're there. It's pretty much like that, actually. With a little bit, with some underlying wow factor, yeah. The wow factor's still there. But it's not difficult. It's pretty easy. But still, we have to keep respect the you know, our ancient habits of, again, believing that that camouflage is causative. So if we're a little bit nervous, of course we're nervous. We think we might lose causation, be annihilated. No experiencing. We think we'll suddenly be unable to experience anything at all, unable to experience it all. And, you know, that's like a living death, annihilation. There is no such situation, but we have conjured it up in our minds. Now, nobody, well, not many like to see this. I mean, I like to see it because I know it's leading very directly to freedom. But, I'm able to tolerate a lot through a lifetime of working at this. But I'm certainly aware of everything I've gone through, of realizing that most, you know, most don't want to see this. Their minds will spin off into something else very quickly. They say this is distasteful. I had to empty out this shop vacuum full of filthy dust dust, just hideous dust. I opened it up and it just billowed everywhere, and the wind hit it and blew it into my face. My clothing were super saturated with all this dust, my breathing it in, my eyes. And I had to keep working at this and change the filter of this shop vacuum. Yeah, that was a nasty business, I'm telling you. But, you know, I just said, well, I was cursing the whole time, but I did it. That wasn't any fun at all. But, you know, I just said, well, you know, hey, it's got to be done. And so I did it. It's not that bad. It's actually a couple parts funny, because I hit my shirt to try to get some of the dust off, and like a cloud of dust just came out of my shirt. I'd never seen anything like that before. Very fine dust. So, looking at this, you know, we're so chagrined, kind of like, oh my gosh, we really have to look at this? Yes, we do. Yes, we do. But once you get used to looking at it, then it's not such a big deal. I know how to get that filter off now. I know how to kind of be more careful in the future if I have to do it again. I really didn't know what I was doing so much then, but now I know. So I say, well, yeah, it's a messy business, but not, we can minimize that. So certainly, our situation our fears, it's a messy business. We're quite frightened that we'll be annihilated. And thus we're afraid to succeed. They call it the continuity fear. We're very afraid of success on the spiritual path. We try to avoid it at all costs. So our minds will spin away from this simple looking. We'll be looking at something else. You know, a minute from now, the mind will realize they're looking at something completely other than this, and oblivious to what we looked at before. You'll think, what was I looking at before? I don't have a clue. You know, completely oblivious to it. Clouded up, supposed to rain tonight. Nice. A little quarter inch. Keep California at least a tinge of green. So we get frustrated on the spiritual path because we say, hey, I'm just missing the profundity of it. I can't, what happened to it? I thought I had it, now it's gone. Well, yeah. Because the taboo is so strong. We're so frightened. We say, well, I haven't lost my experiencing yet, but since the taboo's been there for so long, it must be that when I look at it a little closer, that's when the problem will happen. So every time we go back to it, we're worried, like, maybe this is the time where I'll look at it a little too closely, and poof, you know, my experiencing will vanish, and I'll be annihilated. So of course we're scared to go back time and time again, and we only look at it very furtively, like, I don't know, if I should look at this or not. Easy to get distracted. I go back to graphics, which are a waste of time, really. I mean, I can convey here so much more. And so much more quickly. Graphics takes, they're so time consuming and just chew up the time. It's just amazing. And I could just, by sit here, we can get to it, you know, boom, directly, quickly like this. But where's the audience for that? You know, who in the audience is able to stick with this kind of thing hour after hour after hour after hour, looking again and again and again and again and again and again and again? Yeah, that's just very difficult for most of us. We get frightened. We say, oh, I haven't been annihilated yet, but I think it might be coming. You know, and there must be some basis for my fear. Okay, keep in mind that All conclusions from a false premise are going to be mistaken. Now, what scares us so badly is we tell ourselves, wait a minute, it's not possible that all these conclusions could be wrong. Some of them, must be not as bad as others. They can't all be wrong. Yes, they can. All conclusions from a false premise are going to ultimately be false. And one of the main fears and defensive fears we have is we just feel like, when something's wrong, we feel something like, oh, it can't possibly be that bad, can it? Can it? Yes, it can. It can be totally mistaken in every which way, actually. And yet we tend to think, no. Maybe it's wrong in some ways, but not in all ways. This is why there are those who exploit that, the demagogues and stuff. Pathological liars often become politicians, actually. And what they do is they simply do so many things bad and wrong that we feel guilty and wrong about even accusing them. Say, hey, wait a minute. Look at you. You've done so many terrible things. And they look at you like, wow, you must be very biased and intolerant by accusing me of so much wrongdoing. How, obviously the fault lies with you. You're a little bit crazy, actually. This is a very common thing. Psychopaths will be so mistaken in so many ways, and they feel that invulnerable because the people generally react with guilt, saying, I don't dare accuse, don't dare see that they're doing all of this stuff is bad. Now they must be doing, something right, and they can't possibly be lying all the time, can they? And it gets us over and over and over. So the fact is that from a false premise, all of that is going to be false. All of it. None of it's going to be true. You never get truth from lies. Never. From a false premise, a lying premise, you never get truth from that. You cannot. So all of it is wrong. It's all mistaken. So all attempts to bring causation to arrogance is futile. None of it works. None of it is ever causative. No attempts at camouflaging arrogance are ever causative. None of them. And those who hide behind this guilt, saying, "Oh, you can't say none of it. Some of this stuff I'm working on is certainly going to be causative or is causative." I mean, how dare you suggest that all my efforts, none of them are helpful? That just shows that you're intolerant. You're bad, and we shrink away from it. So, it's very difficult in this world to speak the truth because we shrink away from it, feeling that, well, I'm being too severe. I'm the one who's bad. I'm accusing them of severity that they don't have. I'm accusing severity where it isn't there. I'm being overly severe. So I'm the one who needs to back away, and I'm the one who needs to compromise. This is what the problem you get in this world. So anyone who speaks the truth here will seem to be fanatical. And people say, well, you're a fanatic. You're a zealot. You're fanatic. You refuse to compromise. You refuse to back away. Well, all attempts to make arrogance causative are futile. All of them. All attempts to make, say that camouflage makes arrogance causative. None of that is true. No matter how many statements you make about it, not a single one is true. But we take that as meaning that somebody is being, cuckoo. They're being crazy. They're being fanatical. And we don't listen to them. Tend not to listen to them. We tend to listen to those who are pathological liars and keep assuring us that some of the lies they're telling are true. And we think, yeah, okay, I'm a good person. They make you feel like a good person. Yeah, don't accuse me. That makes you a good person. So oftentimes, pathological liars become political leaders and get the most power in society, because people feel guilty if they don't go along with them, and they feel reassured by saying no, they're a lot of what they do is good, they're a good person, and it makes them feel like I'm a good person too because I'm not being overly severe. We feel like we don't want to be overly severe, we don't want to be too accusative here, don't want to be overly severe, because why? We're terrified ourselves of being overly severe and saying, no, none of camouflage is causative. And we're saying, oh my gosh, I've lost causation. So we want to say, no, some of it is. So we're very vulnerable to demagogues, pathological liars, demagogues who end up basically having, we give power over our lives to them, or try to, you know. They don't really have it, but we pretend that they do. And some who are a little maybe more willing to look at it or say, hey, wait a minute, look at these politicians, you know, these leaders, they're so corrupt. And the other people are a little less willing. They don't want it to seem to be too severe. You know, they say, how dare you? What a bad person you are. What an intolerant person. You're obviously, you know, you're just an evil, angry, mean person to accuse them like that. I think they can't possibly be that bad. You know, I mean, have some faith in human nature. They say, have some faith. Oh my gosh, be compassionate. Don't be so accusative. You know, even though the evidence is in plain sight, they'll say, no. You know, there must be another reason for it. I don't want to. I'm not going to accuse them of that. It's no, because they don't want to recognize in their own lives that their attempts at camouflage are non-causative. They don't want to see it. The fear is they'll lose all experiencing. This is the fear of the abyss. So you have these battles in this world, very severe battles going on in the world right now. Because, you know, some say, hey, look at this. You want to have our lives run by, you know, criminal cartel, and the others are saying, oh, how dare you say such a mean, nasty thing about these people? They're trying to help us.
Yeah.
And you get conflicts, severe political, ideological, cultural conflicts over this. So it's best to get free of that in your own mind and just realize camouflage is never causative. None of it, ever. Speak in abstraction, total abstraction as much as possible. Now, of course, when you do this, you really cannot take part in the political realm and cultural realm so much at all, because what happens is both warring parties will look at you and they'll suddenly look at one another and saying, hey, I think we see a way that we can get along a little better, because they're at each other's throats right now. And they realize that this is a bad thing. You know, they're tearing each other apart. The world's being torn apart by people that are so ideologically at each other's throats. And they say, we've got to come to some sort of compromise somehow. And what compromise do they come to? They seek for a scapegoat who seems to be even more fanatical than either one of them, right? And they say, let's both agree that fanaticism is a bad thing. And they'll say, yeah, I'm sorry that I accused you of being too fanatical. You know, maybe you had some good points there. And then the fanatical will say, yeah, I'm sorry I appear to be so fanatical to you, and I kind of got upset with you by calling me fanatical. And because we both now can see that really neither one of us are fanatical at all compared to this idiot over there who's claiming that you know, absoluteness, complete absoluteness with no compromise whatsoever. That's the one that's really dangerous. That's the one that we should be careful of. That's the one we should persecute. That's the one we should scapegoat. This is how the world works. This is how the world works. So really you cannot be part of that political and cultural wars and all that kind of stuff. You can't be, because you're going to be scapegoated for sure. Truth will be scapegoated for sure. They'll both hate you and think that's a remedy to their own conflict. So Holy Spirit told me, don't comment on any of that stuff. Don't make comments. That was a tad. Holy Spirit, you know, tells me that, like, you can't do this and succeed at the same time. You're going to get into trouble. So I don't comment on any of that stuff in terms of, you know, forums, blogs, message boards, you know, comment sections or nothing. No, I don't. Sometimes I want to, you know, but obviously I realize that the whole board will turn on me and say, hey, we're trying to have a meaningful argument here, you know, and you're a true fanatic. Neither one of us wants you here. You're too fanatical. We just want to get our pathological liar in there instead of theirs, you know. And you know, they're fighting over that, but we don't really want to recognize, you know, the clear depths to see the whole thing clear. Now we want to keep it murky. So you find that you're not welcome in those realms at all. I'm not sure what realms you really are welcome in, actually, in this world. I haven't found any. Because the fear, again, what's the fear? That camouflage is causative, that it turns our arrogance into, makes it causative, and therefore has effects. And what effects could it possibly have? Claiming God is imperfect, claiming that we had a deal with God that has to move God off of perfection. That's the only effect that could possibly have. There isn't any way, other way, for something other than God to be causative, other than something was able to move God off of perfection. There's nowhere else for God to go except off of perfection. But of course, in believing that camouflage is causative and believing that we've moved God off of perfection, we then feel that we can't rely on God to remind us of perfection. And we then... So that really throws a wrench into it, even more so, doesn't it? So we end up compounding our fears. It's not like we have fear A, B, C, D, and we look at one and we look at another and they're all separate. Actually, each one is heaped upon our shoulders. Each one compounds. You know, fear A is on our shoulders, and then fear B gets put on our shoulders. So now we got both fear A and B. And then fear C is there, so it's A, B, and C. And then fear D, A, B, C, D. And it gets heavier and heavier and heavier and heavier and heavier, the fear. One, you know, definition of guru is one who's very heavy and is not moved by any of our fears, you know, is not moved by it. Oh, another way of looking at it is they're able to remove the heaviness of our fears. Our fears are weighing us down so severely. The guru is light, is able to remove the heaviness of all those fears, or at least help us look at them. This is what removes them ultimately, is seeing them clearly and just looking at them. And then say, oh, okay, that's not causative, so why should I fear setting that down gently? It's not causative. I mean, setting it down is not going to make it causative. Even doesn't matter how I set it down, it's still not going to be causative. So why should I fear setting it down? I'm not going to lose any experiencing because of that. How are we doing? It's doing okay. Okay, great. So far, so good. So far, so good. Now, sometimes a video cuts out for no reason. I can't understand why the reason, other than I guess the Holy Spirit decided that's enough. So when I guess it gets enough, suddenly it's like a error message pops up. Error. The video stops working, stops capturing it. Then I just roll with the punches. Say, okay, that's fine. Colas are very weird. Have a diet, caffeine-free diet Coke. It's terrible. But sometimes, I can remember times where colas tasted just great. Other times, it just tastes terrible. It's a weird thing. It's you have to drink the cola. I'm not exactly sure why sometimes it tasted really good. But I would say drinking a cola out of a bottle, okay, when it's cold but not too cold, and when the day is warm and you're thirsty, somehow it can have a good taste to it. But this sugar-free Diet Coke isn't going to taste good no matter what, and neither is that sugar-free Dr. Pepper. Actually, though, when it was warm, oh, that was bad. It's not getting easy to get a good cola. But I remember I used to like Pepsi, Diet Pepsi. But then I had one, you know, a while ago. I don't know how long. Maybe it was maybe a year ago. Or I tried one. It tasted like, you know, glue. Or I was drinking. It was horrible. Wow. I said, how in the world could I ever have liked that? Good Lord, it tasted chemical-ish. So I guess our tastes change over the years. I couldn't get into Diet Pepsi. I used to drink Diet Pepsi. Went through a phase of Diet Pepsi phase. And it was probably just more mental than anything, because for a while there, you know, Diet Pepsi dethroned Coca-Cola in this country, in the United States. In a lot of countries, Coke has such a monopoly that they don't even let Pepsi in the country. Coca-Cola is a very powerful international company. Extraordinarily powerful. A lot of countries drink enormous amounts of Coca-Cola products. They are, you know, profoundly influential and powerful in many third world countries, for instance, and many countries around the world. People, kids grow up, that's their drink, that's their go-to drink. It's part of their culture. So Pepsi came in into the 60s, or, you know, Pepsi generation, we were told. You're the Pepsi generation. They're very clever, their advertising. And people really got on that bandwagon. Pepsi, I think, captured, you know, more market share. And so, like, Pepsi was the thing. Now it's Pepsi really took a dive. They're trying to bring it back, like, as if it was some awesome energy drink or something, but not really. So, what's our trouble again? What's our trouble again? See, now a guru is able to be clear about this all the time, constantly. They can be chit-chatting, chitty-chitty-chatting about anything, but they never lose clarity about it. So as soon as you're ready to return, they return, help you return. Yeah, let's go back and take a look at this. It's not trouble. What are we afraid of? That camouflage is causative. Afraid of seeing the camouflage as what it is. It's mere camouflage. It's camouflaging our arrogance. Belief that we can arrogate to God. Meaning, we can give God qualities that we decide God has, even though God doesn't have those qualities. We can just merely say, God, this is the way you are, arrogating to God. That we can't do that. We can't change God. So it's just sheer arrogance. Has no causativeness, has no causation. And we're trying to camouflage the arrogance to make it seem like it does have causation. So it's really our camouflage is what we think is the root of causation. So we don't want to see it as camouflage. So we want to say, no, this is just life. So how do we avoid seeing that as camouflage? By claiming that God made it all. God made the world. God made bodies. God made death. God made punishment. God made our suffering. God made all. God made everything. We think that all of this camouflage, God made all the camouflage. And then we say, see, oh, it's not camouflage. It's just reality. This is how we avoid seeing that it's camouflage. This is how we avoid recognizing that it's not causative. You know, that's just in the service of arrogance, because we're afraid that if we see it's camouflage, it's not causative, we'll lose all causation because we think it's causation. So, to avoid this terrible fear, what do? We claim, you know, God did it all. God, this isn't camouflage. This is God's creation. God loves this creation. It's not camouflage. It's all causative. And then we build up religions around that, and get very serious and very angry. You know, say, how dare you question our camouflage? We got this great defense system claiming God created all our camouflage, so how dare you suggest that God did not do it? You're trying to annihilate me. I'm going to annihilate you. You know, and this is the trouble. And we're always very self-conscious because we realize it is camouflage deep down. So we're always nervous about some other tribe over there saying, We all agree here on that this is legit, and God created this. But that tribe over there, they're looking at us and saying, no, God told us that we deserve your land and all your goods, and you're supposed to be our slaves. That's what God told us. God created us as special, not you. And we say, hey, wait a minute, no, God told us we're special, not you. God said we have right to your land, and you're supposed to be our slaves. And then before you know it, they're fighting. All politics is spiritual, actually. All politics is spiritual. It's getting a little cool out here. Boy, this storm clouds are moving in. Today was a beautiful sunny day. But suddenly, the rain clouds have suddenly made this very fast push. They're moving quite quickly. Wow. So, it's not as warm as I expected it to be. I'm just hanging out here with this shawl, trying not to get too cold, just like we're hanging out in this world, trying not to get too cold as these, maniacs in the world are plotting the course of our future. So they believe, they believe that they need to do this to convince themselves that they're not dealing with camouflage. They need to feel super important, super special. And they say, I need to feel super special, so you need to do everything I tell you to, and you need to be a slave, and that'll help me feel super special. Otherwise, I'm afraid I'm going to be annihilated. My specialness will disappear. I'll be annihilated. So they, they want everyone to do what they say, and they want to be able to pass all sorts of laws and control your life, and be able to lie with impunity, be able to do anything they want to do with impunity. Ultimately, what they want, what do these maniacs want? They want to be dictators, or dictatoresses, and they want to be able to do whatever they want to do with impunity is what they actually want, and they feel then they'll be safe. At least they hope they will. They say, and so they'd be able to say, no, this isn't camouflage. They say, no, this is causative, not camouflage. So they don't want to be called out on their camouflage activity. Say, hey, wait a minute, that's just camouflage. No. They say, no, you can't say that. The empress has no clothes. The emperor has no clothes. Being emperor or empress means that you don't get called out on not having any clothes. Everyone says, what great high fashion. What amazing fashion. Let's have our tailor do something similar. And so we're living in the world, this insane asylum, where again, those who are desperate to not recognize that this is just camouflage and it's not God created at all. God is not trying to camouflage reality. He's not trying to camouflage truth. God's not engaged in some creation of trying to hide truth, tell lies about truth. God's not involved in that. We are, because again, let's go over this again, because we don't want to blame ourselves. We don't want to attack ourselves over this. Yes, we have to take responsibility, but look at it this way: we on a whim, on a lark, on a venture, we said, hey, let's see if we can be greater than God. Let's see if we can change what God is. Let's see if we can be better than God, and we. You had this arrogance, and then we realize, wait, this doesn't work. It's not causative. So let's make a cause. How do we make this causative? We'll camouflage it. We'll say it's something. It's not something different than what it is. And so we got so wrapped up in how clever we, creative we are, in trying to camouflage, that we didn't realize that we were basically saying that Camouflage is causative. It's making what doesn't... We're making what is totally non-causative, causative somehow. And therefore, if we recognize camouflage as just mere camouflage, and it's not causative, we'll lose our causation. We won't be able to experience anymore. So we suddenly have this terrible fear, this terrible dread. I experienced this coming into the world when I was about maybe 19 or 20. I decided, hey, it's time to be enlightened. And so I said, okay, let me drop this nonsense here that's going on in this world. And so I just lay down on the ground. I said, I'm gonna do what Ramana Maharshi did and just let go of all delusion right now. And I just said, okay, here it goes. And I started doing it, and then suddenly I felt this massive tsunami of fear, dread hit me, and I was like just sweating and trembling, and it was just incredible fear. And I said, what in the world is that? Where did that come from? Well, that comes from the belief that camouflage is causative, and that by letting go of it, I would lose all causation, and therefore would be unable to experience. And I said, uh-oh, how did that happen? See, we don't even put two and two together. We don't understand where our fear comes from. And so we project it onto others and say, someone else is causing me to be frightened, so they must be threatening me. I must feel threatened. So we imagine that we're vulnerable and can be threatened, when in fact we're really not vulnerable and can't be threatened. But this is the only other way for us to explain it. Instead of coming, repenting, and seeing what we're really doing, we claim, no, I'm vulnerable, and somebody's trying to attack me. And so then we play out these games of vulnerability here, which we have throughout history. These are just games we're pretending, and we're playing to help one another out. We think it is to acknowledge our vulnerability, and someone's trying to attack us, thinking the fear is coming from there. It's a misdirection, a disassociation of the fear by playing these, you know, games of vulnerability. However, many ways to play that game. The fear comes from feeling we're going to lose causation by recognizing our efforts at camouflage. That's where the fear comes from. It doesn't come from any actual other source at all. And we, by displacing it onto body vulnerability and others attacking us, you know, this hides from, it's another attempt at camouflage. Essentially, it's more camouflage. So there's layers and layers and layers and layers and layers, if you want to look at that way, of camouflage. Just lots of it. It's all over the place. It's all, we engage in it to an extreme extent. Any sense of fear, vulnerability, all this stuff is camouflage. And anything that so-called happens to us, we actually make it happen to us. So that it will camouflage where our fear is really coming from. That's why people have, you know, stuff happen to their body, get attacked, and all those troubles. They're making all that happen because it's a very clever way to distract us from where our fear is really coming from. And again, if you think, well, how can anybody ask to be attacked or insist on being attacked and you know, make that happen? Well, keep in mind that they feel the alternative is to lose all experiencing. So they think that the price they have to pay for experiencing is to be attacked. And so they're very willing to pay that price, actually. They feel, well, that's just the price I gotta pay, so I gotta pay it, and that's all there is to it. And so this is extremely prevalent in this world, this defense. So all we're doing is we're simply looking at this and seeing it clearly in a relaxed way and say, oh, okay, well, I can see that. Let's bump it up here. The sun has pretty much, well, it's gone behind the clouds, actually. Maybe it'll peek out again because we're... Most people are used to clouds. We're not really used to clouds. We're used to days being like spectacularly beautifully clear. And so when a storm front comes in like this, we're kind of looking like, wow, that's interesting. I almost want to like videotape it. Look at this. It's very unusual. So we've expanded here, looking at vulnerability and attack, and all this is a way of distracting us from where the fear is really coming from. I guess it's just fear of recognition that this is all this camouflage work we've done, trying to disguise arrogance. It's still all arrogance. All of this is just arrogance, but we're trying to put it in a way that seems to disguise it, to hide it, to camouflage it. It's like someone wearing camouflage gear and pretending that they don't exist. Well, of course they still exist. Just as much if they wore a business suit, they're still there, just the same. But wearing camouflage gear, others can't see you so well. You think, hey, maybe I don't exist. They can't see me. I'm safe. I have a different quality to me now. So if we think we don't recognize arrogance as arrogance, then we think, well, it's changed then. No, it's just we camouflaged it. So this world and bodies is a very clever camouflage we have used and continue to use, and attack and vulnerability also is camouflage. Now all of this clarification is making me sleepy, tired, because it this, again, the taboo that we have, fear of annihilation, fear of non-experiencing, tells us that if we lose the camouflage, we'll lose our experiencing. So how do we hold on to the camouflage? By insisting it's working. So then we refuse to see any evidence that it's not. To see that it's working means that God is imperfect. So we refuse to see any evidence that shows us that God is perfect. We refuse to see it. Even if it's right there in front of us, we will refuse to see it. Which is more arrogance. Now, sometimes we see more clearly than other times. So when we're not seeing as clearly as before, you just say, well, okay, I'm just resting in the wow a little bit, taking it a little bit easy. I know I might have shocked myself a little bit here, so I'm kind of stunned by what's being said. Take it easy, and don't let your mind wander, get distracted. Just keep telling yourself, no, I'll get back to it. I'll get back to it. Better than ever. That's for sure. Better than ever. Don't doubt in the dark what you saw in the light. Full stop in the wow here. You come to this bridge here where you need to kind of be careful as you walk across. So it's a little down face here. See, that happens in your inquiry, in your consideration, in your clarity, clarifications. You'll have times when you're going really great, and then other times you'll have a little downtime where you feel like you're sluggish. And you just have to get through that and get through it without losing your momentum, without having your mind dart off somewhere else, without getting involved in some other project, just distracting yourself. Without distracting yourself, just keep hanging out. You may say, well, I don't feel so spiritual. Now, that's okay. I mean, feeling wow is very close to spiritual. Holding up against this, the feeling of succumbing, being pulled down into confusion, that's very spiritual. Absolutely it is. So what we're doing here is very spiritual, without attaching a bunch of words and phrases and opening up a teaching right now. Oh, wow, excuse me, I'm so tired. Stress is on in this world, on a lot of people right now. It's... We realize it's not getting better, is it? It's getting worse. Is it? Oh no, we're really in for it now. And then we wonder, what can I do? Well, you can either go to try and make the camouflage even more clever, or you can work on seeing the camouflage for what it is. It's one of the two. One of the two. Culture has changed so much, it's just astonishing. So many things that we did when we were young, which was just basic stuff. Nowadays, they don't do it at all. It just, wow, kind of overlooks some of the basics. But everyone here is very much engaged in camouflage, working on camouflage. You wonder, why is nature so full of camouflage? Yeah, there's a reason for that. The whole situation here is based on camouflaging, arrogance. Absolutely it is. So we ask, well, why is there this world? It's hard to give a straight answer, isn't it? Because really, this world is just a byproduct of our frantic attempt to camouflage arrogance. That's all it is. The bodies, this world, it's just a byproduct of our fear. It's not like it was, we had some primary purpose. Let's make a world. Let's make all this stuff. No, it didn't happen like that. It came about simply because we say we must camouflage our arrogance. And so step by step by step by step, we kept compounding, working on it, working on it, working on it. And we didn't know exactly, what would come of this. We just like going down a road working on it. And, so we're quite astonished by what has come of it. we look at this world and we're just like, wow. It's bizarre. It's weird. It's bizarre. Or wow. I mean, just because we've been so wrapped up in camouflage work that we don't pay much attention to the results, because we keep thinking that we got to keep getting more results, and we can't rest on our laurels. So we really didn't know what's going to become of this effort. Actually, it's all kind of a wild adventure for us. Even now it is. It's just like, wow, what's going to become of this world? We don't know. But it seems like a very wild adventure is in our future here, doesn't it? Wow. No question about it. The intensity is so strong. An attempt to, you know, make all of this causative. We keep pretending that it is. We keep pretending we're bound by it. There's stuff that happens to us. There's situations and circumstances that happen. We're only pretending, like actresses and actors going through scripts in a play. You know, we think, oh, it's just natural. This is how they really feel. This is all spontaneous. No, it's not. It's completely contrived. Completely contrived. All of this existence is completely contrived. It's a contrivance. But it's not one that we had some blueprint ahead of time saying, okay, this is what we're going to do. It's more like we just kept working on developing it. And not really paying too much attention to it. But ultimately, we had to pay attention to it because we decided to, because of all the conflict and deception. So severe. We wanted to take a little hiatus, and so we could relax a little bit. So that's why you find that history is uneven. Our own lives are uneven. It seems to be life happens to us. It seems to be like this. What's going on with my life? We ask ourselves these questions. Well, because it is like we are making it up as we go along. Actually, this camouflage. We are flying by the seat of our pants. It really is this rugged and ragged. It absolutely is. Because we have to keep compounding it. Because, you know, the camouflage we did before, we've got to find some causation for it and claim that this is what's causing it. And then that's more camouflage. And then after a while, we say, hey, wait a minute, this is looking like camouflage. We have to find some causation for this. And so it's like a path that we go down. It's like if we feel like we're just going down this path, constantly trying to shore up the whole situation by finding causation for what's going on right now. Other than our own desire to make camouflage seem like causation, this is what's actually driving it. I'm so tired. I don't know if what I'm saying is making any sense at all. I'm basically out on my feet, but I'm trying the best I can. Maybe this wretched Coca-Cola will Wow. They gotta work on that one. That's not so good. And the aftertaste is bad. Gosh, when the bubbles are hitting you, it's okay. But then the aftertaste, yeah, well, I don't wanna do that again. Good Lord. That's not a winning formula right there. There's all these microbreweries of cola, and then people put them out, and they think they got the better cola here. Well, maybe. I never really drank RC cola. Maybe I have to try one of those. I may have tried one recently that wasn't so good, just to see what does that taste. I know that was in some parts of the country, United States, RC cola. I think it may have been the South. Of course, Coca-Cola's headquartered in Atlanta, South. It's really headquartered, all over the world. They have huge headquarters. talk about a global corporation, there's one. Making sure we're all happy. Happy in our efforts here. Happy with our life here. Say, God put us here. God created us as bodies, vulnerable to being destroyed in infinite number of ways. And God gave us the means by which we could protect the body. And God gave us this world where we could starve to death here and be attacked in so many ways, but also gave us the means to fight off our enemies. And God made us special and claimed that we have the right to do this and this and this and this, and we have higher rights than others. And God did this. Sheer arrogance again. Sheer arrogance. Arrogating to God qualities God does not have. God is impossible for God to play favorites, to have any preferences whatsoever. It's possible for God to make vulnerability totally impossible. Impossible for God to make protection, because there's no vulnerability. What is there to protect? It's absolutely impossible. We're completely free. How can perfect freedom be vulnerable? It can't. So again, this is just this math, this play of arrogance is what we've called the world. That's all that it is. Now we can see the world without this arrogance. This is what we're told, that the vision of no arrogance, vision of no deal, or vision of no arrogance, vision of arrogance-free vision of no arrogance, vision of no deal. We didn't enter into some deal with God where we gave up something and God gave up something. God gave up perfection. We gave up claiming there's imperfection. Vision of no dealness, vision of non-arrogance. We can enter into this. Basically, we just enter into seeing seeing that arrogance is non-causative. And so all is perfect. So all this camouflage we've done is non-causative. There's no cause, no effects to it. So we can see the vision of non-causativeness. Again, there are many ways we can refer to it. Vision of isness. Time hasn't encroached upon isness at all. The kingdom has not been encroached upon by arrogance. And of course we say, God, we don't, this terrible arrogance is threatening us, and is causing us so many traumas. We don't know where it came from. It's just a mystery. But can you help us with this? And can you destroy that arrogance? And God says no. We say, why? What do you mean? It's just threatening us. Because we want to keep our camouflage as causative, and if we see it's just propping up arrogance, then we realize it's not causative. So we're trying to get rid of the arrogance and keep the camouflage. And we think we're keeping causation. So we say, God, you got to destroy this arrogance. And God says, no, I cannot do that, because you are the one who's being arrogant. The Son of God is the one being arrogant. So if I destroy arrogance, I would have to destroy realities. Actually, Son of God is one with reality. I have to destroy reality. So God says, I can't destroy arrogance. You have to set it down. Okay? You have to set it down. But when we make God of destroying our enemies and stuff, that's what we're really getting. One way, that's arrogance again. Arrogating to God what God must do. Say, God, in order to be God, this is what you have to do. That's arrogance. Now, we've gone over this before, and over and over and over again, but maybe not as directly and as clearly as this. So, we should have some familiarity with all of this. mood of the weather has really changed. Yes, absolutely. I like the weather to be like perfect all the time, so I hope that I can have like a mood of perfection all the time. It doesn't change, but of course we know here it does. It does change, and we can't get our perfection from the weather. So we're just letting this soak in and letting the wow, you know, the wow from all of this, just staying with it here. We're in no hurry. This is powerful, powerful witnessing and clarification here and repentance, powerful repentance here. So we're in no hurry to brush it off. We realize that this is packs a punch, and so we will have this wowness, a mixture of elation and trepidation, for sure. We realize that our clarity will fade a bit out of our fear of losing what? Losing causation. Believing that camouflage is causation, okay? Fear of losing that. We recognize, it's just camouflage. We think, it's lost its causation. Lost causation. If we recognize that reality hasn't changed, then arrogance is causeless. And therefore, our camouflage didn't make it causative. So all our camouflage is not can't be causative either. And then we think, I've lost causation. But we haven't lost our freedom, which is really true causation. Haven't lost reality, haven't lost God, haven't lost any of that. So, to see that that camouflage was never causative doesn't mean, therefore, we're devoid of causativeness. To see that camouflage was never causative doesn't mean, therefore, we're devoid of causativeness. Because we don't need camouflage. Truth doesn't need to be camouflaged to be true. And reality is all is totally causative. All has all. Again, let it all sink in. Don't try to figure it out. Don't try to sit here and think and figure it out. Just hear it in this mood of I like hearing this. Like a song. Don't try to figure a song out, just listen to it. And after a while, you know, you're humming it and you kind of like the tune and you get used to it. Now, I like to make these videos as powerful, potent, as helpful as possible. So far, so good, but I'm feeling so tired. I don't know how much more I can do. But again, we say we're just looking. We're just looking at this. We're just looking. We're being kind to ourselves. We're not attacking ourselves. We're saying, where's our fear? We've been trying to displace our fear. Our fear is that by seeing that our arrogance has no effects, well, that means all our camouflage has no effects either. It's not causative. And since we believe that camouflage is causative, believing that it's causing our arrogance to have effects, we're afraid that we'll seeing that it doesn't have any effects, we'll feel we would have no causation in us, and we won't be experiencing anything. So we're very afraid to look at all this that we've been looking at, very afraid, and we're liable to forget about it as quick as possible. this fatigue is one way of defending against looking at it. Say, oh, I gotta go to sleep. Go dream. You know, I'm too tired to talk. That's one of my main defenses is fatigue, sleepiness. I get very sleepy. Won't it be nice to not be so sleepy anymore when I finally accepted this? Wow, that'll be like a rebirth for me because I've been desperately tired and sleepy and fatigued my whole life. Because it's almost so much to the point where I can't even talk. I'm so tired. I really have to rest and rest and rest just to be able to talk. So tired. It's a way of preventing, you know, me from seeing, you know, seeing the truth and say anything about it. It's a defense system. So it's just like our ill health is a defense system. All of this is a defense system. So to not be sleepy, wow, I don't even know what that'd be like. I've always been exhausted. I haven't had a moment that I haven't been exhausted in maybe 45 years, actually, or more since, yeah, more than that. You might even say, haven't had a moment that I haven't been exhausted. I'm always exhausted, never feel refreshed. So, yeah, that would be just like I've been born again. And I feel like I don't know if I'll ever get free of this exhaustion. I don't really quite see how to get free of it. I feel like I'll always be this way, feeling this way, like near death, actually. Which is one way of trying to, you know, in dealing with this information I'm getting out, this clarification, it's so taboo what I'm doing, is I feel like that to protect myself, I think I need to be like near death. So in case that the annihilation suddenly tries to get me, I can always die first. And by doing that, show my goodwill to God. You see, this is the craziness we have, thinking that death is keeping our part of the bargain that we made with God. So basically we say, well, if I keep my part of the bargain, that means there is a deal in place, which means God has to keep God's part of the bargain, and I won't be annihilated. The annihilation will only be temporary. Maybe have another body at some point. So it's maybe a way of staying very close to death, because I feel like I've been like a living death my whole life, in a state of living death, and it just may be that I'm so scared because the taboo in this world is so strong at telling me that, you know, what you have to say is going to cause your annihilation, that I want to stay close to death as possible. I feel like I'm 90 years old on my deathbed. I always feel that way. But I realize it's all in my mind, and I'm doing this intentionally. So I think it probably is because of that. It's like a safeguard. It's the price I've had to pay for looking at all this stuff. Now those who refuse to look at any of this, they can have plenty of energy. They don't have to appear to be near death, but they will eventually reach death, and they'll continue to go on and on in these cycles. But they can have lots of energy because they're not, don't feel that they need to be real close to death just in case that annihilation suddenly jumps up, tries to devour them. They can die first, which we know is not true annihilation at all. And after taping these videos, and after you listening to it, maybe you might feel very tired, and feel like, wow, near, and almost like a near death, a living death, just as a safety outlet, or so we think. So, having wandered in the land of exhaustion for almost nearly 50 years here, I don't even know what it'd be like to leave that land. Really don't. But occasionally I have faint glimmers and glimpses of when I maybe didn't feel so exhausted. But it's a faint memory at this point. And it's really an attempt to black out the consciousness, just to black it out so I completely forget what I was talking about, right? Completely cannot keep the train of thought, cannot keep the focus, instead fall asleep into dreams. I had a terrible dream last night. I can't even fathom such a dream, actually. But it was had to do with, wow, people being shot and executed, and it was just bizarre, absolutely bizarre. I wonder if the world will come to that. They're certainly trying their best, aren't they? The world is trying its very best to go crazy, absolutely go severely crazy, go bonkers, and it's keeps working at it, but also we don't really want to do that. And so underneath that surface, collectively, we're trying to not go completely bonkers here. So by all means, let's not. We don't need to. We're able to look at the, you know, what we're looking at here, and that gives us true hope, and we don't need to then displace our fear and keep compounding our camouflaging. We can ease up on it. We can ease up on all of this, what we're doing in the world. We can ease up on it. We don't have to keep following pathological liars and accepting their agenda for our own. We don't have to keep doing that. We don't have to keep going down that road of worse and worse and worse representation. No, we don't have to do that. We can start to ease the situation, ease up on it. Now, I don't know, will we? I hope so. I hope so. I certainly do. I'm trying to do my utmost for that, to help us ease up on it. When we recognize, you know, what salvation's really about, and just be repentant. Mood of repentance. More people practice the mood of repentance, which is to accept the fact that all of this trouble is based on just our arrogance, our extreme arrogance of believing we can change God, arrogate to God characteristics that God doesn't have. The more we repent, the better the world becomes. Okay, the less problematical it becomes, it seems to us. So really, the task that everyone has in front of them is repentance. Repent means acknowledge the arrogance. Stop trying to camouflage it and say it's not arrogant because it does have effects. See, if we can claim that it's having effects, then we say, well, it's not arrogance, so we don't need to repent. And the unrepentant ones are like that. They keep doubling down on camouflage, keep believing, no, if I just double down one little bit more, I can make arrogance causative. It'll have effects on God. And then I can say, I'm not arrogant at all. It has effects. So, and then they claim that everything will be fine. No need to repent at all. This is a trouble, big trouble. And people are afraid to repent. They say, no, it seems like better if we just double down on arrogance and camouflaging it. Double down on camouflage, and that will make it non-arrogant because it will have effects. It's not arrogant, and then I don't have an arrogance problem. I don't need to repent, and everything should be just fine now. Just this is the mindset of the world, very much so. So we have to somehow give real hope to the world, real hope. So stop doubling down on camouflaging arrogance, which we get more and more arrogant leaders, more and more those willing to double down, those working more and more on camouflaging arrogance. And, you know, that's why they keep wanting to get away with stuff, because that's sheer arrogance and saying, you know, what you saw really isn't what happened. Well, that's just reinforcing the effectiveness of camouflage, isn't it? It's like the Empress having no clothes. She wants to feel that her camouflage is so great that people don't see that. They don't see that doesn't have any clothes. They say, oh yeah, you know, I can see your gown is so beautiful. And then they feel, ha-ha, you see, my camouflage is, look how effective, look how powerful it is. So we keep running, if we don't repent, we're going to get worse and worse representatives and rulers and those who are demanding that we be fooled by them. They want to feel that they're fooling everybody, pulling the wool over everybody's eyes. And this is what we have now. It's amazing what's going on in this country and in the world. It's just amazing that everyone keeps trying to outdo themselves by something that's clearly, plainly seen. Is they say, no, I can't see it at all. It's so camouflaged. I don't even know what you're talking about. You must be crazy. They're trying to give more and more power to camouflage, saying it's causative, it's causative, it's causative, it's causative. This is what's going on. Again, when we drop repentance, now keep in mind that Jesus certainly has helped a great deal, even though it's been subsumed to a large extent into the Abrahamic religions, based on the Old Testament God. All right, Jesus has done a lot of good, a lot of help. And we're not quite as confused as we used to be, right? So we're able to look at this and say, hey, wait a minute. You know, we don't really want to keep being fooled more and more and more and more and more, more severe. And we realize that we do need to repent. So the message of repentance in, for instance, Christianity is a very good, very good message. There's a lot of good messages that Jesus got through, and the rivers are still flowing. They tried to dam them all up and divert them, but they're still flowing to some extent. You know, the water's still there to some extent, yeah. So we're emphasizing that. And again, we're not attacking ourselves. We realized that this was simply, you know, very creative, clever working on camouflaging what we've done, and we've thrown a lot of camouflage onto Jesus so we don't recognize him as he really is. And yet, we still see something there. I say, there's something there. It's really camouflage. I can't quite see what it is, but there's something there. It's been very difficult to cut through that camouflage, I find. And I thought, you know, if it was easy, everyone would do it, but I found that nobody has really quite got there yet. And so we're toiling away at this, but making, I would say, very good progress in seeing through all the camouflage that we've thrown up, trying to hide Jesus from us, really. Because we think that Jesus is bringing our annihilation. That if we don't see camouflage as causative, that we'll have no experiencing at all. So we're quite frightened of Jesus, actually, and therefore we seek to camouflage Jesus and make Jesus into something different than what he is. And therefore, protect ourselves. All politics is spiritual politics, and all spiritual politics is really dealing with fear, isn't it? keep on going here. Time is, you know, it's ticking, ticking on us, ticking on us, ticking on us. There's this demand to double down on camouflage. Everybody says, no, no, I don't see a thing wrong with what they're doing. I don't see it. And they smile and say, see what a great leader I am. Look how much I'm helping you. I'm helping you maintain your belief in causation so you can keep experiencing, you know. Look how helpful this all is. So there's this sort of crazy codependent symbiotic relationship between the pathological liars and those who support and follow them, as they believe they're both helping each other out greatly. Again, the mind wants to wander, so full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow. The practice is to keep bringing your mind back to the truth over and over and over, as many times as you can during, you know, that's why we have these long videos. It's not enough to just see it once. That's common. That's not really a helpful path. Bringing ourselves back to it again and again and again, many, 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 many times. That's really the path. That's really helpful. That's what's effective. It's what works. And therefore, it takes time. It takes time to do that. Because we'll have the wow reaction, and then I'll try to flip the script and get back to, you know, the assertions of clarity. The camouflage is causeless. Yes, I already know that camouflage is entirely causeless. Yes, I already know the causelessness of camouflage. Yes, I already know the 100% causelessness of camouflage. Camouflage is not causing, it's causeless. It's not changing what it's trying to hide. You get the insects with all their camouflage, and yet it's still the same insect. I may have to stop here. It's become very problematic to stay awake. Yeah. Okay. So I think this is a good time to stop. We've gone past the two hour mark, and that's a good strong push here. We don't want to overdo it. And so these videos now are really so heavy, so clear, getting to the root of it, that you might find yourself kind of stunned and tired, fatigued, not knowing what to say or think or anything like that. But that's it. That will clear up. If you just stay with it, that will clear up. And then you'll come back, you know, way brighter than ever. And that'll be great. Okay. I'm going to say stop catcher before it gets forced upon us. All right. Very great. That's it.